I'm denied. And anybody settle down please at the back. So I'm going to give a talk on Apache Hadoop, and this is like an overview talk. I'm going to talk about what are the different components of the Hadoop system. But before that, I'll be talking about how does MapReduce work, and can talk about each of these components. It's fairly a lot of material to cover. So if I have time at end, I will also cover a little bit more about Hig, Hive, and HBase. A little bit about me. I work for iMovie. It's one of the largest independent mobile ad networks out there. And we built this system Hadoop because we're facing big data challenges as at other firms like Twitter, Facebook, and Google. And I'll actually illustrate some of the findings that, or some of the evaluations that we have done when we actually use some of the Hadoop software. And we started using Hadoop when it was fairly new, which was about close to 3 years back. And we made some design decisions. Those design decisions, some of them hold, some of them do not hold anymore. For example, we evaluated Hive at the time, it was not very mature, but Hive has become very mature right now. So, yeah, so let's get started. But before that, how many of you have used Hadoop in some form? Can you raise your hands? A fair bit of people. How many are aware of what MapReduce is? There's still a few who don't know. Good, thank you. So, we live in a world where the stuff that we do, everything kind of leaves a trail. Plus, there are systems which actually keep on capturing what you're doing. For example, central entities like social networks, right? Twitter, Facebook. Whenever you comment, whenever you like something, anywhere on the web, all of it kind of gets captured. And if you look at the number of interactions that we have online, and it's a humongous amount of data. There's a humongous amount of data, and there's a lot of system generated data also. It has been around for quite a long time. For example, astronomical data, weather related data, and so on and so forth. Also financial data, whenever there's a trade on the stock market, there are various other parameters associated with that that get captured. It's a huge amount of data. Lately, a trend we have seen more and more is that governments are opening up whatever data they collect, for example, census data, economic indicators, and opening it up. I think there are a few talks on that as well in this conference. So it is possible to kind of take all of these metrics and, you know, use and crunch data and correlate them and find out things that were not possible before. So this is actually bringing a lot of transparency. There are various apps, and for example, Shazam is an app where you can use machine learning and use whatever learning is there from different processing different audio data and actually use that. And then we have high resolution video. So all of these adds up to a huge amount of data. So we are truly in a world where the amount of data that we actually store, consume, see is just exploding. Hadoop is one way of actually making sense of all of this data and using it, finalizing it. It provides a framework where you can actually take all of this data and process it. So when we talk about the data stack of the big data, what are we talking about? Mainly, we're talking about these four layers. Everything is in a fairly different state of maturity. Let me talk about each of these layers first, starting from the bottom. Data storage. So one of the big challenges is when we actually take all of this data and capture it, how do we actually get all of this data to central entity, right? For example, imagine a problem, in case of Facebook, they have servers all around the world, or say Yahoo, they have servers all around the world. So you capture the data, but you probably have to get it to a central entity where some of it can be processed and then stored reliably. Right. So the challenges at this layer are how do you ingest data, how do you take all of the data, and how do you store it reliably? So whenever individual machines kind of fail, how do you get around it and your system still works? Second layer on top is, once you have got all of the data in, how do you predictably run jobs on it, do different kinds of analysis that you've coded on it? How do you kind of schedule jobs? How do you actually do some amount of validation as well? For example, we know that PIN codes, at least in India, have 6 digits, right? So whenever data comes in, you want to have some kind of validation in, so that whenever the upper layers start using it, they do not run into errors. So you can, sorry, I'm losing my voice. So basically the role of this layer is to add predictability to the whole process of actually taking all this data and processing it in a predictable way, so that a data analysis layer can take all of the different aspects of the data. So what is the difference between data analysis and data processing? So data processing is mainly, in some sense, a slightly dumber layer where it does not have context. The main focus is on the infrastructure, whereas in the data analysis layer, you have a lot of context. The different aspect of data analysis layer is also you can take third-party data. For example, you have data related to geography, right? And then you want to take some economic related data. For example, in a neighborhood, you know the geographical location, say Bangalore, in Kormangala or Indianagar. You know a certain set of people live in certain localities. So when you want to overlay some of this data, there are disparate sources. So you take all of this data and then you can do overlays and then kind of get insights which you would not otherwise do, could not otherwise get if you had these two data sources used separately. So you have to kind of join them. There are challenges in kind of doing retrieval, doing validation, and combining this data in ways that you can get new insights. And finally, when we have taken all of this data, we have analyzed it, we have to visualize it. This is a fairly nascent field right now. There is not much out there in terms of this. It is a very active research area, because when you take all of this data, right? For example, let's take the case of InMobi, right? Whenever we have ad network, so the three typical entities that are associated with, there's a publisher, there's an advertiser, and there's a user, right? So all of these, the people have attributes. For example, the user is, mobile world is represented by the handset. So the handset has different attributes. For example, the size of the screen, whether it plays video, what kind of videos it plays. On the publisher side, what kind of site it is? Is it a sports site? Is it an entertainment site? Or is it some other site? Right? So when you take all of this data, it becomes very difficult to take multidimensional data and plot. So this is an active area of research where you can represent the relationship between different kinds of data, because data in isolation without context does not have meaning. So you want to have visualization where after you have done all the processing, you should be able to figure out what is the relationship between different kinds of data and what is the correlation between different aspects of the data, right? So this is the data vision. So if you look at the Hadoop stack, it's actually fairly strong in the data storage and the data processing, and to some extent it's getting better at the data analysis part as well. But there's not much in Hadoop about in data visualization. So people use tools like R, and we use toolkits that are available in JavaScript, for example, InfoBase. I'll talk a little bit more about those in the later part of the talk. To on top of the aggregated data that is come through all of this process. Okay, so when we talk Hadoop, I just wanted to figure out what do people actually think, right? So what I did is, this is a kind of visualization that is known as a word cloud. It's generated using a site anybody can access and use it freely called Wordle. So I pointed it to a vendor's blog, that is Gutenberg's, you can see it there. And what are the kind of keywords that came up? The first one was Hadoop, obviously. The other was data. Hadoop is an Apache project, right? The components are MapReduce, HDFS, people use it for learning. There's also, just because of the time when the snapshot was taken, you can see they had a lot of focus on education. So you can see stuff related to education. For example, there's education itself, there is students, and there's student. So basically, this simple infographic can tell you what is the relationship between what are the words that are correlated and what are the components that are playing in that ecosystem. A little bit about the basics of LTFS. LTFS is a file system that is designed for storing large amount of data. So stuff that runs into terabytes across huge amount of clusters. Yahoo has clusters, more than 4,000 machines. It scales really well. it also allows for streaming data access. So what do I mean by streaming data access pattern is that you can use any language, and as long as you can read and read from standard input and write to standard output, you can actually stream the data out of HTTPS. So actually, it provides a generic framework where you can write MapReduce jobs in any in any way, and then in any way, and then use all of these use all of these jobs to actually analyze data. It also is assumes that it will run a large amount of commodity hardware, so that it actually has affected the design of HTTPS. For example, it has fairly good failure fault tolerance and fairly resilient. I'll talk a little bit about HTTPS architecture. HTTPS, there are different kinds of nodes. When I mean a node, it's a machine. Then there's a name node. What the name node does is it stores all the metadata related to a file. For example, when was the file created? What is the name of the file? How was it actually stored under a cluster? So on and so forth. The data node are like the workhorses of HTTPS. These are the ones that actually store data, right? So the data nodes themselves actually store what is known as chunks. So whenever you actually copy a file onto HTTPS, what happens is it's broken into chunks, and depending on the replication factor, it's actually put in three different ways. You can also make HTTPS rack aware. What that means is when you have large number of machines, you put those machines in different racks, and because of that, the amount of latency and fault tolerance that you can have in a rack is dictated by the distance. For example, a complete rack page, HTTPS can still work if a whole rack goes down. So typically, if you configure HTTPS to be rack aware, what it does is, depending on where you have first stored a file from the local disk, you copy to HTTPS, stores a chunk on that server, then it takes, suppose a replication factor of 3. So that means that chunk is replicated like 2 more times. It takes that other chunk and puts it on a machine which is in the same rack, and also takes a chunk and puts it in a machine which is on another rack. Right? So what happens if that rack which has 2 replicas goes down? Then you still have a copy, and name node knows that, and what it does is it figures out that the chunks are under replicated, and then it will actually copy those chunks around very nicely. So MapReduce is the paradigm that is the basis of program model for Hadoop. That is slowly changing because there's something new called DR, which allows for different kind of models to be run, for example, MPI. Because MapReduce works well for a certain class of problem, but if you go into social network analysis, or if you want to figure out what is the relationship between different aspects of a group of people, or a hierarchical data set, it doesn't work really well because of the way it is designed. I'll give a quick demo of how it works in Python. So I've defined 3 variables, x, y, a, b, c. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to define a function map. What it will do is take the length of these 3 and calculate the length. So I'll define one function and run it over each of these. So it's very simple to do that. So I say map So now I have defined map. So what map will do is if you take this function, length of x, and apply it to each of the variables that I have defined here. Okay. So now L contains the length of each of those. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a reduce. So what reduce will do is we'll take all the values of L and it is just going to add it up. So what I will have is the length, total length of each of these things. I have 9 here, so those who cannot read, I define 3 variables ABC, A equal to ABC, B equal to XYZ, and C is equal to PQR. Then I define a map function. What a map function does is you define a function and then take that function and apply to each part of the data set. And then the reduce state, what you do is now you have all the these partial results you add them up. And this is exactly what the MapReduce framework does. So the way it works on Hadoop is you fire a job, the job gets translated, and you define a map and reduce function. When you fire a job, what happens is it gets distributed across all of the data nodes. The data nodes are where actually all the data is stored. And I talked about chunks, right? So now each of the, for example, you have a 2 gigabyte file, and you have a chunk size of 128 MB, right? So you will have about 16 different chunks. So, and if you have maybe 20 data nodes and they're stored in 16 different machines. So it will take and split each of this and run the map function, whatever you have defined on each of these. Now, so now you have parallel, right? So it will take each of these and then it will map and it will run it locally. So you have a data local property. So now you have all the partial results. It will take all of these, shuffle them across, which is the shuffle phase that is happening here from the different machines. Bringing to the point of fault object, any of these fails, the name node or rather the job tracker will actually know about that and it will restart the job on another node because of the different replicas that you have. So anyway, so once all the maps are completed, or even before sometimes the map is completed, depending on how your reducer is done, all of that data is taken of that state and then it is run on individual node. So on the first step, I have run the map function, and the second stage, I have taken and collated all the output of the individual maps, and in the third step, I'm taking and reducing it, right? So it's fairly intuitive, and this kind of works for a large category of problems that, let's talk about the data storage here. So I talked about HDFS, but Hadoop can equally work well with other kinds of file system as well. You can use them as a store, you can access them. So you are not tied to a HDFS as such. Though it's a great file system to use. You can use something, if you're using stuff in the cloud, I think there's a talk on, there was a workshop at least yesterday on how to use MapReduce on the cloud. So you can actually use S3, both in a native mode and also in a block-based mode. And it works beautifully. I have used it myself, and it's very easy to have your own Hadoop cluster, process the data there and push it on S3, or use S3, pull data from S3, run it on your cluster and send it back. So it actually works seamlessly well from the Hadoop command line as well. HSFTP is another way. HTTP is a very popular protocol. So HDFS works beautifully over HTTP as well. There is something called a Cosmos file system. There was a company called Cosmix that actually at some point was competing with Google, and they built a KFS system that works recently from what I've read on the internet. I've not used it myself. And there's another file system called CPage where it can work. So it actually supports a lot of data storage. So you're not tied to any one entity. And because of the way it is structured, you can actually pull data from disparate sources and use them as well, including there are tools for actually pulling stuff from databases as well. So when you actually take all of the data, you want to kind of serialize it because it can be in kind of object format or for simple reason that it's more efficient to store that. So for data serialization, you have something called as Avro. Avro is again a Hadoop project. It works natively beautifully well. I have also used Protobufs. There's a talk tomorrow that one of my colleagues is doing on a system called Yoda, which we built to do ad hoc analysis on our network. And in that, we actually used Protobufs, and it worked really nicely. Thrift is another library that Facebook has provided. What Thrift does is actually something very nice. Hadoop actually provides a Java API through which you can access the HDFS file system. And you need not use it. You can use a Thrift service that can act as a front end for the over HDFS and probably use it from any language, because Thrift can provide code generation for any language. So you can actually use Python or C or any of the other language and then link it with Thrift and use it really nice. RC file is something very interesting. How many of you do analytics or looking to do analytics in Hadoop? I would highly recommend that you should look at RC file. Concept of RC file is actually very simple. What it does is, whenever you have a row, typically Hadoop or any kind of RDBMS system stores it on the row-based system, right? But if you look at analytics systems, right, what typically you do is you are more interested in columns. So, for example, what is the average temperature of the city over a period of time, right? Now, in the database, you can have the geolocation, the lat long, and the temperature, and maybe rainfall and other things. But you typically will run queries like, what was the average temperature over a period of time? Or what was the average rainfall over a period of time? Or what was the max or the min? So typically you run functions which are based on individual columns. So RC file actually stores data in a columnar format. And the good thing is, in terms of performance, it works really well, because you're accessing data in a columnar format. Second thing that storing data in this format does is that it provides extremely good compression. So take, for example, numerical values. They're typically going to be repeated. For example, the amount of rain that a certain city has got over a period of time is going to be within a range, right? Now, when you know that range, you can actually compress really, really well. And you can possibly get up to 30x or 40x compression than otherwise if you just store in other formats as compared to RC file. So I would suggest that you look at RC file if you're looking at doing analytics. Hadoop Archive or HAR is another format which is used by Namenode to kind of archive, and it can also be used by other people for archival purposes. So Hadoop natively supports archiving through HAR. Hcatalog is not kind of in data splits archiving, it's a kind of a meta store. For example, we'll talk going forward about PIG and Hive and each of these stuff. So each of them have their own semantics, each of them have their own ways of accessing data. What Hcatalog does is it kind of provides an abstraction over that. So no matter whether you're using PIG, whether you're using Hive or using raw, map, your own custom Java map, it provides an interface where all three of them can run simultaneously, and it works really nice. It is a new project. I don't know how stable it is, but something that people can look at, especially people who are looking at different kinds of tools for analysis. Okay. So one part is the storage, but how do you get stuff from multiple machines or even multiple data centers? There is a project called Scoop. The premise of Scoop is actually very simple. What it does is it allows you to take a dump of the database. For example, if all of your metadata, typically any kind of system, all of the metadata data is actually stored in a database. So the database is not closed off. You can still use the data that's stored in the database. Use Scoop and define the schema, saying that how do you kind of retrieve what kind of data and what is the location, and you just need to specify that, and it will keep on getting that data, and your jobs can keep on running the analysis that they want. And it works really well. It's fairly stable. The other three in that category are Flume, Scribe, and Kafka. Flume is actually a Hadoop project. Scribe is actually a project that has been developed by Facebook, and Kafka is a LinkedIn project. Each of them provide different kinds of trade-offs. The documentation from Flume is really good. I can tell you offhand that if you are looking at data transfer, please not look at Flume as it is now. And the reason for that being, Though the architecture is really nice in the sense that it provides sources and defines the architecture of source and sink, when kind of define a data source and define an output, and you can apply, you know, transformations all along the way. In addition to the transport that it provides, it just doesn't work well. We had a lot of errors with that. This space was black for a long time till Scribe came along. Scribe works actually really well. And we use it on our network, and when I mean a network, just to give you an idea, we have four different data centers around the world, and we keep on transferring data across data centers, and it works really well. You can't use it just off the box. You have to do some customizations. We have written some customizations on top of Scribe to provide iterator interfaces and so on and so forth. Probably will open source it at some point of time. But Scribe, for data transfer, you're looking at something, look at Scribe. Kafka, I have looked at it and read about it and used it a little bit, but I don't have too much experience with it. But Kafka works really well, wherein you want to kind of go back and forth. So what Kafka does is, in addition to providing the transport, it also, for example, machines keep on going up, so you are transferring data from one data center to another, right? And maybe connectivity is like lately, it just went off, or it's dropping packets due to huge amount of data that you're transferring. What Kafka will do, it will kind of spool onto disk. So Scribe also does that to some extent, but Kafka has really good support. So you can actually go back and forth and provides that kind of interface where you can actually use it in case of failures. It works beautifully in case of failures. My friends at LinkedIn have said that internally, whatever they have is also exposed externally, unlike Scribe, which is like some code term that was done before. It works beautifully in LinkedIn at their scale as well. So it tested. A note of caution though, a lot of people who look at this particular aspect, that is transport, also look at message queues. From my experience, I can tell you that we looked at ActiveMQ, ZeroMQ, and RabbitMQ, and it just doesn't work well for doing large amount of data transfer, that especially across data centers, because the amount of CPU consumption, the amount of reliability that you want is just not there. One more thing about Scribe and Kafka is also it provide a publish and subscribe kind of mechanism. That allows you to kind of sort by topics, or especially if you're doing like taking social streams, you can actually sort based on the metadata that is coming in into the queue. Zebra is a columnar storage that I don't know how well it works. We looked at about 6 months back, and it wasn't, or rather about a year back, and it wasn't very good usable. So you can kind of try it out and see if it works. If you are looking at analytics space, Zebra is another thing you can look, but I would still recommend RCFile. And there's a key value store that is built on top of HDFS for HBase. If I have time at the end towards the end of talk, I will talk a little bit more about how HBase works. So that's the data storage part, getting data into the system, storing it. So we move on to the next part, which is now that you have all the data in the system and it works beautifully, right? How do you actually run jobs predictably? What are the frameworks that are there, that are available, so that you can use them? Azkaban is a good framework. I think there's a typo. I don't think it has an edge, but you can search for it. It's a product by LinkedIn. It provides ways where you can specify a process or a tag, and then you can schedule it. Uzi does somewhat similar, but it's a little painful to use. At least it was when we used it. But I think over a period of time, it has become stable. So Uzi also provides scheduling, it provides recovery from failures. So you can basically, if a job fails, you can rerun it, or you can do some kind of validation and trigger off jobs. Azkaban and Uzi can be extremely useful when you don't know when the data will come onto the cluster. So when the data comes onto the cluster, you can actually trigger a job, and when all the constraints are satisfied. So these two frameworks are really good. At InMobi, we have built something called as Ivory. What Ivory does, it does a lot more than scheduling. It provides a data feed framework, and it looks at data coming in as feeds. So what I mean by that is, suppose you have three or four different things. In our case, we have ad server logs that are coming in, that click logs that are coming in. Once somebody has clicked, then they might go into a purchase, which is conversion logs that are coming. So you have three different disparate stream, and you know, customer comes and touches on each of these aspects. So you want to combine all of these. For example, you want to figure out what is the drop-off ratio, how many people saw the ad, how many people actually clicked on the ad, and how many people actually bought a product, right? So the only way to do it is kind of do a cross, take all of these feeds and do a join on those feeds. And when you're doing it at our scale, it's extremely difficult, because the amount of traffic that we are doing at this point of time is about, we are showing 3 billion ads per day. And the amount of data that's coming into the network is around 2 terabytes. So the scale is fairly large. So we had no option but to build Ivory, because there's nothing out there that kind of fit our needs. This is an open source framework actually. We have open sourced it. You can actually take a look at it. It's on GitHub. So if you search for Ivory, InMobi, and GitHub, you should be able to find the link. So you can do a lot of stuff. It's fairly nascent. For example, you can do cross-field validations. You can do your own validations, such as, you know, data should be in a certain format, it should have certain constraints, so on and so forth. And actually, you can write those rules, and then only the data will get ingested and processed in the system. So it provides for that. One underserved area in when you're building a Hadoop cluster, and we really struggled with this for some time, was Ganglia, our cluster monitor. And we use Ganglia for getting all of the data from a cluster, like how many JVM instances are there, how much CPU is getting used on the cluster, what is the amount of when a shuffle phase happens, there is a huge spike of activity on the network, right? So is the network the bottleneck? Because when you're doing processing at large scale, anything could be a bottleneck. The disk could be a bottleneck, the CPU could be a bottleneck, memory could be a bottleneck, or even the network could be a bottleneck. And depending on the kind of jobs that you have, each of these can be a bottleneck. So it provides you an overview of, you know, how the cluster is doing at this point of time. It provides a individual view, and you can actually patch it to give a very, very granular level metrics. For example, what the number of page faults that were happening, how many times a certain JVM was instantiated. So you can get stuff related to JVM, you can get stuff related to individual machines, you can get stuff related to even individual hard disk. So it's a fairly good framework to do cluster monitoring. So we use that, and it's working beautifully in production for us. And we use Nagios for alerting, and that also has been working fairly fine. There's also an Apache project called Chakwa. The last time, about a year back, we looked at it wasn't that mature, it didn't work for us. And I thought for our needs also, it was fairly heavy. And so we didn't look at Chakwa, but Chakwa is another option to the combination of Ganglia plus Nagios for cluster monitoring. Finally, there's ZooKeeper, right? ZooKeeper is a distributed coordination service. So what that means is, you have processes running across different machines. So how do they figure out, who would be, like, for example, the leader? So you have algorithms for the leader election. Or you want to find out that, you know, how do you kind of see if a machine is up and running? Because you might want to have one or two critical services. For example, if you're running a thrift server and everybody is using the thrift server to access data on the cluster, the thrift server should not be down. So you can actually use ZooKeeper, and it works really well out of the box to actually monitor and, you know, restart any of the services when they go down. And it provides fairly sophisticated algorithms for that. Finally, data analysis. Hadoop is not very strong here. The only Hadoop project that we have, which is good, is Mahout. Mahout provides good classification algorithms. It provides good clustering algorithms. But probably it is the best at recommendations. That is what most people use it for. Internally, us, and I have talked to other people in other companies such as LinkedIn or Twitter or Facebook, they typically write their own MapReduce jobs on top of HDFS and the MapReduce framework. Because there's no generic library out there that works for everybody. Piggybank is a set of UDFs, user-defined functions, that work really well if you want to read, load, store data, and it provides a bunch of user-defined functions. I will talk about a little bit about user-defined functions later in the talk. Then there's Hive. Hive does, it provides a SQL-like interface on top of Hadoop. Again, that is something that will be covered later. Pegasus and Jira. Jira works on top of Hadoop. Pegasus, I'm not too sure how well it's integrated with Hadoop. But Jira works really well. If you want to do graph analysis, for example, you want to do social network analysis, find out which are the people who have the most number of connections and who are the influencers in a certain kind of network based on certain kind of algorithm. Then you would actually have to traverse a graph and look at the connection between different kind of nodes. So for that, you probably need Jira, but most people again roll out their own stuff for this. There's also a library called AllReduce that works really well. And someone suggested that Mallet is really good, haven't used it myself. Finally, there's Pig. Pig provides a high level abstraction, it's a data flow language. Where you can, every time if you want to run any job on Hadoop, typically before Pig, you had to write a MapReduce code. It was fairly tough to kind of go and write MapReduce code for every piece of software out there. And what happened is when you actually go and write a job for every software out there, it just takes a huge amount of time to actually get anything processed. So what if you have a hunch? You know, what do you want to do? Rapid prototype. Pig is kind of the solution for that, or you can use Hive provides a language but HQL, which is very, very close to SQL itself. So if you know SQL, in some sense you know HQL as well. Pig is more of a data flow language. It's somewhere between it's somewhere between a programming language like Python and SQL. So I'll give an example right after this. So Pig works really well. What Pig does, it takes whatever you are written in Pig and translates it into MapReduce jobs and, you know, gets the result and provides very, very good abstraction. Pretty much everybody I know uses Pig in production. We also use Pig in production for pretty much everything we do. The only place where we actually use MapReduce is when we know a job is going to run for a long period of time, and we want to optimize the technology. So when we have figured everything out and we know that this is the way it's going to run, only at that point of time we can move to MapReduce. But the gains are in some cases not that much. Probably we might get a 20% gain. So the Pig is getting better and better, and actually at a stage where in some cases if you write a MapReduce job by hand, a normal programmer, might actually be slower than Pig, because Pig has become very smart at figuring out what is the correlation between different kinds of data and how to do the data accesses. So it's pretty smart right now, and so if you're looking at getting your feet wet with Hadoop, you should start off with Pig. So Pig provides a very easy learning curve, or something like Hive, but Hive setup might take some. There's again not much in the data integration space. Ambrose is a way, so when actually Pig runs a job, it doesn't run just one job, it runs a series of jobs, same about HQL. So one job starts and then there are dependencies. So how do you know which job will end when and how it works? So Ambrose actually provides a good visualization for that. What is the correlation, what is the dependency graph between different jobs, and you know, how do they depend on each other? There's Tableau, which is kind of open source. There's GWT. Jeffy is actually extremely good if you're doing social network analysis. I don't know how many of you looked at InMaps, InMaps.LinkedIn. So there is a InMaps.LinkedIn provides, takes all the LinkedIn data and then clusters the people that you know into groups, maybe based on your school friends, your college friends, your colleagues at your first, second, third company, and does a very good job of that. So if you want to look at a graph and interconnections, then Jeffy is extremely good.
So this is not really a question, but a little addition to the data analysis piece. So I come from a background where we do recommendations for early job seekers, we're building a recommendation engine. So you spoke about a lot of tools in data analysis, but you also mentioned that it is a little weaker as compared to another system development. So I would like to talk about there's a new database that has come. It's a graph database called Titan. That's a distributed graph database which supports Edgebase and Cassandra. And you can use all your MapReduce functionalities with the power of a graph database. So if you know a basic traversal using Gremlin or any other thing about that, you can go with Titan and use the power of MapReduce with Edgebase and still be able to.
I didn't have enough time to talk and I was very slide about what next. So today we are just using the MapReduce framework, but what Hadoop, the next generation, that is actually not in production but testing with Yahoo and Facebook and a couple of other places, is that it provides other ways of running jobs. It's called YARN. Look it up. For example, it provides iterative algorithms don't work really well with MapReduce. Graph traversal doesn't, as you said, does not work really well with MapReduce. So it actually
depends.
I haven't evaluated that, so I'll take a look at that. So this is how you can reach me. I'll put up the slides and there's a lot of supporting material that I had for this, but unfortunately there's not much time. I'll put it up on GitHub maybe in a couple of days. And this is how we can reach me. I'm fairly responsive on Twitter and email as well. So I'd love to hear from other people about what they're using, because every time I talk to different people, I figure out. For example, I haven't thought about Titan. Yesterday I found out about a very awesome interactive visualization tool called Chapo. So this, especially the analysis and the visualization space, is actually fairly it's changing really fast. Thank you.